On this video, we're going to try to do both the overview and the comments, so it'll save you a little bit of time in dealing with it. So let me go quickly through the assignments. What you need to do is to review chapters 21 and 22 in the Mounts book. And if you don't have the Mounts book, if you don't use that, look for the imperfect active and the imperfect second aorist active and middle. So it'd be chapters 21 and 22 in Mounts, or those topics in the other. For Tuesday night, you have, of course, the translation assignment. The translation assignment is going to involve Matthew chapter 13. It's a split assignment because it deals with the parable of the sower, or a better name, the parable of the soils. And it is chapter 13, verses 1 through 9, and then verses 18 through 23. 1 through 9 is the parable, and then 18 through 23 is the interpretation that Jesus gave to the disciples of that parable. So you'll want to take a look at those things. For your Wednesday night assignment, the good news is for you, bad news for me, but the technical problem with the quiz for this week prevents us from having a quiz, so you won't have a quiz for this unit. So you can relax on that, but continue to review your vocabulary, if you will, and try to make sure that you do understand what's going on there. Then your Saturday assignment, of course, is going to be an exegesis phrasing and a sermon outline on the same information, same passage of Scripture in Matthew chapter 13 that you dealt with before. Make sure you're following in both the translation and the rest of the assignment the grading rubrics that are there. And remember also to take seriously Dr. Mounts' comments in that chapter where the translation appears. That, of course, takes care of your assignments. Be sure to get those done. Get them in on time. Don't get behind here. So if there's any way we can help, please let us know. If you're getting behind, if you need to talk to me, give me a call or send me an email, and we will try to find some ways to help you if we can. All right, now I want to move to, I'm going to be doing two things at once here for just a minute, but I want to move to the situation with the comments on the passage, on the parable of the sower. And that is going to involve a passage that appears in both Matthew and Mark. But what we want to do here is to try to just give you a little bit of overview on that parable and what Jesus was having to say. Jesus' setting, of course, is Jesus comes out of the house where he was and comes down to the seashore, but the people are so pressing that he gets into a boat and moves out into the water, which does two things for him. One, it makes it easier for the people to hear, but also it makes it possible for him not to be overrun or overcrowded by them. But now he can present this word to all of the people who are there. It very well may be that as Jesus sat there in the boat, he looked up and saw a farmer sowing seed. And as he did so, he began to teach the people using that very common story. Like he often did, he used stories a lot to try to teach the people. He did so because he wanted to apply it to the disciples. If you look at verses 10 through 17, the passage in between where you are translating, you will notice what Jesus is trying, it's how Jesus is trying to explain that. He knew that the disciples could hear, they could ask questions, but he wanted to communicate with the rest of the people as well. And so He wanted to teach them something and wanted them to apply what they heard to their own lives. That, of course, was always his goal. So what do we learn from the parable? If we're going to see an application of it in our own lives, what is it that we learn? Well, a couple of things right off. We learn, first of all, that he is the sower. And certainly, that's a very clear representation. He is the one who sows the seed. The seed, of course, is going to represent the Word of God and the message of God that he has communicated to us through Jesus, that he continues to communicate to the church through those who are his messengers. The third thing that we can learn is that dirt is dirt. There are all kinds of dirt. And I think that's the focus of this parable, that he is saying there are different kinds of soils, and it is the condition of the soils that determines whether or not the seed is received and whether it becomes a fruit-bearing plant as a result of being sown in the soil. So the difference is in what happens in the changes that are made in the soil to make it distinct and to make it like it actually is. And if it's not right, then what happens to change it? That's how it applies to our lives. The purpose, of course, of planting the seed is for plants to grow, and the purpose of the plants growing is to produce fruit. You can certainly easily see the message that Jesus is trying to communicate about the gospel being sown and sprouting and then bearing fruit as the end result. So for us, the decision makes the difference. What decision have we made that determines the changes that take place in our lives that makes the soil what it ought to be? Well, I would say we need to remember for the Hebrews, the heart is the decision point. It's where decisions are made for the Hebrews. And as a result of that, we need then to look at the heart responses of those who hear the word as it is sown, and what are those responses. So let's look at four responses that Jesus talks about here. The first response that he talks about are hearts that are packed. They are like the soil where a pathway has been made, where people have walked on them as they walk through fields or around the edges of fields. If you have any experience of being in a field, you can see that very easily and see that the dirt gets hardened and so no seed is able to penetrate it, and there's nothing that can grow in that situation. So here's the application. He provides the word. We have ears to hear, but those who have these packed hearts do not listen to what's being said. And so what happens is the birds come along and take it away, or as he says in the application, Satan takes it away. So the question for us is, and the question that we need to communicate as well as we sow the word, is what is it that packs our hearts? Is it emotion? Have we allowed our emotions to run away with us? Have we allowed the circumstances of life to color our emotions that sometimes distract us from hearing what God says? Maybe it's intellect. Maybe you're just so smart that you think you know everything. Or maybe it's just you're so smart that you think that you have the answer and you don't need an answer from the outside. Maybe it's disobedience. Maybe that's what packs your heart, that there's been such a disobedience that the calluses have built up on your heart and has made that hardened. Maybe it's selfishness, self-centeredness. And that's the thing we see throughout all of history, is that our tendencies are either toward self-indulgence or self-centeredness. Self-indulgence means we want to go our own way and do our own thing. Self-centeredness is that we are so focused on ourselves that we're distracted from everything else. Maybe it's ignorance, just ignorance of the word. Maybe our hearts need to be softened so that we can hear what he has to say. So that's the question for us on the packed hearts. The second kind of soil that he talks about is the heart response that he talks about would be shallow hearts. It's the metaphor is a soil with a thin layer of dirt over bedrock. And that, of course, makes it very difficult to for anything to grow. The question for us then is, what is your rock? What is it that makes you fail to endure? What is it that makes when the seed is sown and it sprouts up, what is it that makes it grow quickly but then wither? Because there's no depth in our lives, and what we need to do is let him change our hearts. The third heart response that he mentions here would be crowded hearts. These are represented by the metaphor of the thorns, where we get distracted, where the seed is sown, where the word is sown in our lives, and it comes up, but there are so many other things that are there that it hinders the growth of the word in our lives, and it keeps us from being what he wants us to be. So again, the question comes back to us for personal application. What are our thorns? Is it sin? Is it that self-centeredness that we talked about? Is it anxiety? Is it that we are worried so much? Is it a fear of risk, a fear of trusting him, a fear of listening to him? Is it busyness? Is it a facade that we built up so that other people will look at us and think what we want them to hear? Then Jesus gets to the main point of this parable as he talks about a fourth heart response, and that is the hearing hearts, those who listen. And as a result of listening, the seed is planted and the seed begins to grow. And as a result of that, the plant grows and then fruit is born as a result of that. This is what he wants us to be. He wants us to be listening so that fruit can come out of our lives. He speaks, we listen, we obey, he bears fruit in us. So it is bearing fruit as opposed to making fruit. We don't make the fruit, he makes it, but we bear it because we are the instrument. His sowing is a seed. And as he sows that seed of call, of a call to commitment, of a command to love God and love others, to change, to grow from the inside, to grow toward fruit bearing, then what he wants us to do is to hear what he has to say, and he wants to see those seed begin to bear fruit in our lives. So look at this parable. Think about the words that you see there, these different responses of the soil. Keep your focus on the sower. Keep your focus on the word that's sown, but also keep your focus on that which can change by his help, and that is the condition of the soil. So let's see what we can come up with on this.